Okay, let's begin. I'm Lisa Lippincott. I'm here to attempt to answer the question, what is the basic interface? I say attempt because this is a hard question, and I don't expect I'm going to get it absolutely right, but I think this is this talk may be a decent jumping off place. But before we begin, this is a sequel of sorts to my talk here last year, How We Reason About Procedural Programs. And for those of you who weren't here, and even for those who were, this is the major takeaway, I think, from last year's talk. We routinely prove that our programs work. How do we know? If we didn't, our programs would hardly ever work. We can't explain the fact that our programs function by chance alone. Yes, you can interrupt me. The proof behind a well-written function is mostly evident in its text, because that's what we mean by well-written. If somebody can't read our function, figure out the reasoning we intended, and run through that reasoning, it's not a well-written function. I'm going to say there are a couple of gotchas in that. I think I listed five last year. That humans are better at picking up on than computers. But if you get rid of those five, there's a very good, a computer should be able to pick up your reasoning. And of course, sometimes the intended proof is wrong. Now, it is of course possible that the intended reasoning behind a program doesn't actually show the program is correct, and the program is in fact correct nevertheless. We don't want those programs. If the intended proof is wrong, you need to go back and fix it.
What do you mean by intended proof?
I mean the proof that the programmer who wrote that program thought showed it was a good program to write. And of course, the other way the intended proof goes wrong is that it's just not a proof. And that one leads to an awful lot of bugs. Not every bug, by the way. Some things are broken by design, but there are a lot of bugs that come from the programmer thought they knew what was going to happen, and in fact, their reasoning was wrong.
Does a unit test count as a proof?
A unit test is not a proof. Here I'm talking a mathematically rigorous proof. A unit test is definitely a helpful indication that your program is correct. But, yes?
You referred to two different kinds of scenarios here about the intended proof being wrong. You said one scenario is the intended proof is wrong, and the other one is it's not a proof. And mm-hmm. I'm trying to understand what you meant by that distinction. Mm. Can you explain?
Is that really a distinction? That's, I think by wrong, the question is, I'm saying two different things here. I'm saying, on the one hand, I talk about the intended proof being wrong. On the other hand, I talk about the intended proof not being a proof. I think the intended proof not being a proof is in fact a wrong. I would go further and say that if the intended proof does not match what the program actually does, that's also wrong. So there's a little bit more broadness to it. If you intended that proof to work for a different program, you're still wrong. And of course,
Yeah, so when you talk about proofs, you didn't mention what the theorems are.
I didn't.
That were proven.
No, that's today's talk. Oh, the question is, when I talk about proofs, I didn't mention what the theorems are. We will get to that shortly. So I do want to say that if you know these three things, and maybe I've convinced some of you, this is the natural question to ask. Why aren't we having computers check our proofs? And on one level, yeah, that looks hard. But this is not halting problem hard. Halting problem is having a computer check for any possible proof. This is a much easier thing than that. Figure out the intended proof and see if it's a good proof that matches the program. And I think I have part of the answer to this question, not the whole answer, on the next slide. The biggest thing is we generally aren't clear about what needs to be proved. And this happens particularly at the function interface level. We don't write formal interfaces for what we expect from our functions. And the parenthetical deserves a bit more than a parenthetical here. Little digression. About 200 years ago, mathematics went through a crisis. A new mathematics emerged from the crisis, which was based on a philosophy called Platonism. The idea that mathematical concepts, such as five, exist in some alternate universe without any time in it. Everything is unchanging in the Platonic universe, and we access that Platonic universe with the eye of our imagination, or if you go back to the original, by remembering it from before we were born. This has a number of problems. The mysticism is really kind of wacky when you think about it. It's non-local in the worst way imaginable. But the big problem from today's point of view is that it leaves us with a mathematics that is talking about unchanging things, and our mathematics is lousy about talking about change. So part of the project here is to bring mathematics into the real world where it talks about change better than we're used to. Now, it's not that we can't do mathematics about change. We do that. It's just hard. Mathematics has a poor user interface for talking about change, for talking about programs. Yes?
So being here at the Aspen Center for Physics, it calls to mind that physicists deal with time all the time, and they use math. So why isn't that math good enough for programming?
The question is, physicists talk about math, time, they and change, and they use math to do it, and why isn't that good enough? The answer actually turns out to be, it kind of is. The non-Platonic mathematics is based on ideas that can be traced back to Emmy Noether, a mathematician around the turn of not the latest turn of the century, but the previous one. The Noetherian theories are based on ideas of symmetry, and these have great purchase in modern physics. So I'm not going to get too deep into that, but maybe if we go fast, there'll be some. Another important thing, and this is really the heart of today's talk, we don't write down all the details of function interfaces. It turns out it would be ridiculous to write down all the details of function interfaces. They're complicated and boring, and I think a lot of it can be left unsaid because everybody mostly agrees on them. And if we can get better agreement, we can get this solid even without writing down every detail every time. But we do have this problem that we don't even agree about what can go unsaid. We don't agree on what the basic interface is, And so when we write an interface as a deviation from the basic interface, we don't even know where we're starting. That leaves us with a question: what's an interface? And I'm going to give you some notation now. This is where the talk goes into a bit of fantasy C++. It could be fantasy some other language, but I like fantasy C++. Here is an interface. It's an inline function. It has two salient points. It's inline, and it may have this word implementation in its outermost scope. The word implementation divides the function into a prologue and an epilogue. That's my notation for interfaces. And of course, you have to match up the interface with an implementation. Here's an implementation. Together, the implementation and the interface form a function. The execution path through the function looks like this. We come into the function, into the interface through the prologue. When we get to the word implementation, we execute the implementation body. Then we come back and execute the epilogue. Fairly simple. It's almost like implementation is a function call to the implementation body. But there are three differences. One is there's no question about where it goes. You don't name the implementation at this point. The caller of the interface, the caller of the entire function, has picked an entire function to call. That is, when you call a function, you call an interface implementation pair. And so this just goes to whatever implementation was specified in that call. Second thing, and second and third are kind of technical. The parameters of the function are the parameters of the implementation. Parameters of the interface are the parameters of the implementation. They're the same objects, not copies, not possibly eluted copies, same objects. Likewise, the result returned from the implementation body is the result that the function is going to have if the function exits. And in the epilogue, we can refer to that result with the word result, which is implicitly defined at the implementation point if the function doesn't have a void return type. Questions? Simple enough, actually. Yes?
Maybe I'm jumping ahead. If I am, please tell me. Do you have things, guarantees in this world, like that your function parameters are consts so that you can inspect them afterwards, or that nothing is passed by reference, or that things are value types?
Okay, the question is, do I have guarantees about things like things being parameters being cons so I can inspect them afterwards, or things are value types, or things are not references, or a few other things like that. There is one, and it's fairly simple. If a parameter is const qualified as declared in the interface, it must also be const qualified as declared in the implementation. Yes?
You specify void as return type and no parameters to foo. Is that always true, or is that just I put something there because there has to be something?
The question is, this function takes no parameters and returns no results. Is that always the case? And certainly that is not always the case. This is just how I wrote this function. Yes?
What happens if, before the epilogue, you move return or do something strange with the value that you're returning? Are you always able to inspect the return value in the epilogue, or are there any restrictions?
The question, if I understand it correctly, is are you always able to inspect the return value in the epilogue? And the answer is that if you can't, you are likely to violate some assertion. And we are all about proving our assertions correct, so your proof shouldn't go through if you screw that up. Let's see. Right. So we have execution path through, yes.
I have two questions that I'm hoping will be told, come back later. Should we be worried about exceptions at this point, and should I be trying to frame coroutines around this?
You should be trying to frame the question is, what about exceptions and coroutines, and how do they affect this? The answers I have are, exceptions will come later in the talk, coroutines will not come later in the talk, but should come later in the future. So we have an interface, we have an implementation, we know that we are always calling a matched pair, and I'm going to draw in a caller over here, and we will have this is the execution path when you make a function call to foo. It's about what you expect. Pre-call region, prologue, body of the implementation, epilogue, back to the post-call region of the caller. And I draw that not because it's surprising, but because I want to do local reasoning on our programs. I want to cover the execution of our programs in a set of overlapping neighborhoods, reason about each neighborhood independently, and then have those proofs stitched together to tell us global things about our program. This limits us. There are things you can't prove this way. And maybe in the future there will be something more we will work harder on that. But there are a lot of good things you can prove locally. So I'm trying to get the local case done first. Here's how we divide this call in this part of the execution path into neighborhoods. There's a calling neighborhood. The calling neighborhood includes the pre-call region and the prologue. There's a mysterious gap here at the implementation. The calling neighborhood resumes with the epilogue and the post-call region. That's what we're going to be reasoning about when we reason about the correctness of bar. There's also an implementation neighborhood. It starts with the prologue. It includes the implementation body and includes the epilogue, and that's all. That's what we're reasoning about when we're reasoning about the correctness of the implementation. And I want to say there is some, so the interface is where the neighborhoods overlap. And where the neighborhoods overlap, we are going to pick one. Maybe there's some odd case where you pick more than one, but you try not to pick zero. We're going to pick one neighborhood to be responsible for any problems that happen there. So the caller is responsible for errors in the prologue. The implementation is responsible for errors in the epilogue. And of course, if the prologue and the epilogue have further calls to other interfaces, the responsibility gets divvied up a little more complicatedly, but you just follow this rule. Also,
by responsible, do you mean the caller would be responsible to pass the correct parameters to satisfy the requirements of the prologue, or do you mean like if there's a bug in the prologue, the caller is responsible to fix it?
The question is, do I mean that this means the caller is responsible for passing the right parameters to the prologue, or if, or do I mean that if there's a bug in the prologue, the caller is responsible for fixing it? Not quite either one of those, but close. If there's a bug in the prologue, the programmer who is writing the caller is responsible for if there is, say, undefined behavior in the prologue, that's the fault of the programmer who wrote the caller. If there's undefined behavior in the epilogue, that's the fault of the programmer who wrote the implementation. So each neighborhood holds responsibility for certain sorts of problems. Yes?
What if there's undefined behavior in the implementation? Is that the responsibility of the prologue?
No. So responsibility goes to neighborhoods. The prologue isn't a neighborhood. There's an implementation neighborhood, a calling neighborhood. That covers everything that we see here. So anywhere there's a solid line, that neighborhood has responsibility for things that go wrong. Yes?
Is the programmer going to write the prologue?
Yes. The question is the programmer going to write the prologue? And
you said yes, and it's the author of Foo that's going to write the prologue.
Usually it is the author of Foo that is going to write the prologue.
So if the author of Foo dereferences Null directly in the prologue, that can't be the responsibility of the caller.
You
don't mean to say that.
So the statement is that that I have just heard is that if the caller of if the prologue, if there's a dereference of Null, say in the prologue of Foo, is that the suggestion is that that's the responsibility of the person who wrote the implementation, because they probably also wrote the interface, and so it should be their fault.
I mean a direct and dereference of Null. I don't mean
yes, he okay. He means he means a direct dereference of Null. I'm going to say yes. I mean what you didn't mean. If there's a direct dereference of Null in the prologue, then it is an error to ever call that function.
Okay, fair.
We seem to agree now, yes.
The way I think I understand it is that assuming that the prologue is written correctly, if the prologue isn't satisfied, then the responsibility is on the caller. But we're assuming that the prologue is correct.
So the question is, are we if the prologue is, we're assuming that the prologue is correct, is, I didn't quite catch everything you said, but not quite. I think I think this will explain the problem. We're dividing our reasoning. When we are reasoning about the implementation neighborhood, when we're reasoning about the implementation neighborhood, we can assume if we got to the implementation neighborhood, then without undefined behavior, the prologue was correct. Oh, let me finish that sentence first. When we're reasoning about the calling neighborhood, we need to prove that the prologue will be correct. But if there's a problem in the epilogue, we can say that's not our problem. Yes.
So, because I've had the privilege of a lot of earlier introduction to your thinking, I think I might have an insight into what you're saying here that could help other people, and it would be really gratifying if you'd confirm or deny that. So, what I think you haven't told us is that the prologue is really the specification of requirements that the caller will use to understand the function. And the epilogue is really the specification of effects that they will use to understand the function. Therefore, if the prologue goes and dereferences null, the caller is expected to see that that's, you know, okay. This function is never okay to call. that right?
It was a long statement. I'll try to paraphrase, and it is basically right. So the point of the prologue and epilogue is that the prologue specifies under what circumstances it's okay to call this function. If you can't make the prologue execute correctly, you shouldn't be calling that function. Likewise, the epilogue specifies the situations under which it is okay to return from this function. If the implementation can't make the epilogue work, the implementation should not exit through the epilogue. I do want to make one quick note about local reasoning. Local reasoning is local in another sense. If we look at the translation units, the implementation has one or more translation units in which it is defined, and the caller has one or more translation units in which it is defined, and those translation units must overlap at the interface. And we can do this local reasoning entirely within a single each local piece of our reasoning happens entirely within a single translation unit. And that's a really nice property. Yes?
Is that why that interface is inline?
Yes. The question is that why the interface is inline? And yes, inline has exactly the right property to get you there. It has to be defined in every translation unit that uses the function. Okay, now we know what an interface is. We can ask, what is the basic interface? And here's the basic interface. That's really the answer to the question posed in the title. The basic interface is the one that says nothing in the prologue and nothing in the epilogue. It's just blank with the word implementation in it.
That interface ought to have a null dereference in it because it's not allowed to do anything. Right?
So the suggestion is that this should have a null dereference in it because you shouldn't be allowed to call this interface. And I will say, no, that's not quite true. The empty implementation satisfies this interface.
Yeah. And I'm saying, what's to call the empty implementation?
Okay, is it a good idea to call things with empty implementation? That's probably not the way to optimize your code. Yes?
So I guess up to this point, I was thinking like of the epilogue and the prologue as kind of like restrictions on the surrounding context, you know, like the inputs and the results. And so, like, I was thinking here that it could be that the implementation could be anything, but that sounds like it's not correct. It's that the only implementation that would work here is one that does nothing, because an empty epilogue implies. I was confused as to if it was like it could be anything or it has to be nothing.
So the question here, and I think good, particularly since we went off on this little tangent, is does this interface mean that the function being called is necessarily the implementation is necessarily empty? And I'm going to say no, not at all. It does put some limitations we'll get to later, but no, not at all. There are in fact many possible implementations of this function, of this interface. They might not be. They are maybe not the most interesting functions in the world.
Well, what if it prints to the console? Is that something you expect to have an epilogue to check?
The question is, what if it prints to the console? I'm going to punt.
Are the epilogue and the prologue in the world allowed to have side effects?
The question is, are the epilogue and the prologue allowed to have side effects? Yes. It makes things, we're already assuming that we can reason about procedural programs that have side effects. That's last year's talk. And once you can do that, there's really no reason to say there are special places that can't have side effects, apart from it might be good style not to. So I also want to say the reason this is the basic interface is because we said the basic interface is the interface you get before you write anything down, not because we said the basic interface doesn't say anything. This says only the implicit things. And so the rest of the talk is about what are the implicit things, and that will give us a much better idea of the basic interface. The first implicit thing, no, not the first implicit thing, the zeroth implicit thing, from which all others derive, is this. At the point where responsibility is transferred from the caller to the implementation, there has been no undefined behavior so far. Callers that can't satisfy that are bad. Likewise, at the point where responsibility is transferred back from the implementation to the caller, there has also been no undefined behavior so far, and that's the implementation's responsibility. I know these look pretty trivial. This is just where we begin. And I'll add a little notation, which is the blue dot, which is not so blue on our nearly black and white projector. I will use the blue dot to indicate things that don't need to be said. When I'm writing down something that implicitly would have been there anyway, I'm going to put a blue dot next to it. There is one more thing that comes with this, and it has a little notation to go with it. There's a fancy version of implementation, try implementation. And this lets us say things about what happens if there's an exception. And here we have, if there is an exception, there's still no undefined behavior so far as we exit the function. And this no undefined behavior is when we return from the function. There's implicitly return here, throw here. You don't have to write them. Fall off the end, you will do the right thing. Ah, funny syntax, I think it works. Okay, let's try to write the interface to a simple function. We'll do this function. Takes an integer reference, says, sets it to 5. And the question is, what's the interface for this function? And when we're just starting out, we're going, and this, I think, it's fair to say that the basic interface should let you set this to 5, just as a starter. So the basic interface must say a few things, because there are all these circumstances in which it would be bad to set that to 5. Over here, we have a buffer overflow. Over here, we have you're setting it after we've deleted it. Over here, it was actually a reference to a const object, and we're trying to change it. Any of those would cause undefined behavior here in the implementation. Yes?
This is trivial, but technically the first one already has undefined behavior.
The question is, the suggestion is it's trivial because the first one is trivial because it because already has undefined behavior in the caller.
No, I just mean my point is trivial.
Yes, sorry. yes, he said the point is trivial. I'm going to disagree with you there. The undefined behavior comes at the point of L value to R value conversion, or at the point where you write to the object. Just, this is a perfectly good end pointer. It turns out, as far as I can tell, that you can dereference an end pointer as long as you don't, as long as you don't access the object.
No, you cannot form a reference to a.
And, okay.
Unless things have changed since C++, but, you know.
Okay, I think we are here disagreeing on a niggling point of the standard, and I was kind of surprised it was my way myself. But I think I got that right.
But to your point, it's still undefined behavior before you get to it. You said anything.
No. My point is,
if he's
right, then bar one has a problem regardless of the interface. And so it doesn't really matter if you would rather only consider the last two. So here we have, I put little signs to mark, these are dangerous things to do, but you might have gotten away with them in some functions. Just, we know you shouldn't do those things. And here we have the undefined behavior that results. And this arrangement, danger in one neighborhood, undefined behavior in a different neighborhood, is really what we're trying to get away from by writing interfaces. So I want to put the danger and the undefined behavior in the same neighborhood. And it's hard to move the danger, but we can invent some ways to move the undefined behavior. Here's one. I'm going to write claim writable, and I will tell you up front, that's going to have undefined behavior in these cases. Now, we can reason about this locally because the dangers and the undefined behavior are going to be in the same neighborhood. There are two things I haven't talked about yet. One is claim. Claim is a kind of assertion. It's the logically provable assertion. That is, when I say I'm claiming something, I mean there is a proof that should be locally evident that that execution will pass through the claim to the next statement. If I can't do that, can't run the proof. Mathematically, claim is an existential quantifier on execution paths. I don't expect that, you know, I'm not going to be saying that very many times today, but yes, if you're trying to do the math, claim is an existential quantifier. Writable, I have a slide about. Writable has no effect when assignment to the object that you passed in has defined behavior. If assignment wouldn't have defined behavior, then the behavior of writable is undefined. So writable is a weird little function. It either does nothing or it has undefined behavior. But it lets us divide two important cases from each other, and that's what we're going to use it for. And when I say it does nothing, it does nothing, you know, if you wanted to instrument writable in your fancy debugging implementation, you can do some useful things with that. Okay, back to our program. So we're going to write claim writable right there. And I put the blue dot next to it because I think in the basic interface, when we pass in a reference to an int, it should be writable. So what other function could we have that does this? How else might we write foo and cause some problems that we want to fix in the basic interface? Here's one. Here, bar produces an uninitialized variable. foo reads from that variable in its implementation. That's undefined behavior, L value to R value conversion on an uninitialized scalar. And so we have the same problem, danger over there, fire over here. We're going to fix it much the same way. Claim readable. And now the danger and the fire are in the same neighborhood. And readable is a lot like writable. It has no effect when L value to R value conversion of the passed in object has defined behavior. Otherwise, readable has undefined behavior. Readable actually has behavior, it has, apart from volatile objects, readable is very much like just reading the thing. Volatile objects are funny. And I'm not going to talk about volatile much today. Yes?
This seems like an opportunity to also detect some things at compile time. And I'm not sure whether that fits into your picture or not. But maybe you should just...
Okay, the question is, maybe this is an opportunity to detect things at compile time. And the answer is, yes, absolutely, in a number of ways. We're doing the proofs locally, and there's no reason that these proofs couldn't just be checked at compile time once we have enough computer performance to do it, and I suspect we're there already once all the software's written, and we actually figure out what we're doing. Can you use it for optimization? Yes, I think these things could be used for optimization. Can you use it to instrument things for detecting bugs? Yes, I think it can also be used for that. Yes?
I think what I'm also saying something else, which is that it looks like the C++ interface, the signature of your function, does not necessarily, it does not constrain the type such that actually reading the type would have to compile, and that even the type system maybe even before you get to trying to do these proofs, move the proofs from runtime to compile time, the type system may already be able to detect some of that stuff right away.
That was a really long statement. But it had something to do with can the type safe system have managed to save you from some of these same errors? And my answer is yes. And when it can, that's a great thing. When there are going to be places, I believe, where the type system is just not enough. Okay, back to our program.
Small question, how would you implement the claim writable, the writable function? Because by writing the value, the change was there. Or by trying, or by testing to write.
So the question is, how would I implement the claim writable function? How would I implement the writable function? Claim is another matter. And the answer is, one possible implementation of writable is it's the empty function. Undefined behavior can include doing nothing. That's not always the implementation you want, but I think in your release build it probably is. Mostly it's just there because we can reason about its behavior, or rather its lack of behavior. Lack of defined behavior, some. Okay, back to our function. Here, two implicit claims. Remember, the blue dot means you don't have to write those things down, but they're there anyway. And let's find another function that goes wrong as we build up this interface. I'm going to change this function and that function this time. We're doing something crazy here. We get in an integer reference, we destroy the integer that's there, we placement knew a constant integer there, and then back in the caller, we have undefined behavior because we assigned to a constant that the caller didn't even know about. There's actually even some worse weirdness going on in this case, but this is good enough weirdness for us. Again, you shouldn't do this. It's dangerous. But if you think no one would do that because it's so dangerous, don't do that is probably part of the basic interface. So once again, yes.
I fail to see why this is wrong if foo says that, this is basically rebinding two into the x. If you pass the ref to x to foo and foo's allowed to change it, why is this bad?
Ah, the question is, why is this wrong? We have constructed a constant in this spot and then assigned to it over there, and that's undefined behavior. And you'll probably get away with it in a lot of implementations because that's how we implement things, but it's definitely undefined behavior. I wonder what comes up next. There's another similar problem. Here we're going to destroy it. We're going to construct a new uninitialized variable on the spot and then read from the uninitialized variable that bar didn't thought was initialized or something. And in this case, it could have been initialized. It wasn't. We'd better make sure that doesn't happen. So on the way out, we will also implicitly claim readable and writable for our parameters. Or at least for this parameter. It gets worse. We can also arrange to have something that's not readable when we throw an exception and it gets caught somewhere else. Same sort of thing. We will implicitly claim readable and writable for the parameters for this parameter on our way out, even by exception. Yes. Oh, yes.
Do you intend to have in bar on the far left int x equal to something for this example? It doesn't match the claim readable.
Yes. The question is, should I have written int x equal to something so that it would be initialized and so that these claims wouldn't have been a problem? And yes, that would have been much clearer. This program has multiple proof problems. Yes. Go back one slide.
So here, maybe I misunderstand, but you pass a int reference to foo. So basically, you can expect anything to happen to that, right? So basically foo will modify that. So isn't then one legal possibility is that you will get back an initialized reference? Or
okay, the question is, if I understand correctly, that when you get to this implementation point, anything could happen, and we can't really from this neighborhood, we can't really say that this wasn't destroyed and uninitialized and crazy like that. There are 2 points. One is, we'll see about anything can happen. Another one is that the epilogue constrains what can happen. And so part of our goal is to get the epilogue of the basic interface to put strong enough constraints on what happens in a function that functions don't do the sorts of crazy things we know functions shouldn't do. Yes?
Would it be fair to say that you have just said this is the sensible default, and yes, the function is technically without this epilogue allowed to, do what implementation foo does, but we have chosen this to mean as the basic interface.
Let's see if I can parse that out. The question is, am I saying that this is the sensible default? And yes, the idea of the basic interface is that it is the default, and when we write an interface more explicitly than the basic interface, we are writing deviations from the basic interface. So we say, what parts of the basic interface don't fit our function? What do we have to add? What do we have to remove? Yes?
Okay, so to phrase that again, it sounds like what you're saying is, this is what happens in the default basic interface when you have a non-const reference parameter. If you add a non-const
yes.
reference parameter, you get these default assertions.
And yes, and I will expand on that in a second.
Right.
But yes, these are the default assertions that you get when you have a non-const reference parameter, particularly this one. And these are further default this is a further default assertions that belong in the basic interface because you don't want people thinking this is a good thing to do. I'm going to simplify now. I'm going to invent a function because I was tired of writing readable-writable. I'm going to say an integer reference is proper when it's readable and writable. Yes?
So if you go, basically you're saying that in the exception case, you are by default giving the basic exception guarantee. Because readable means that it's in a valid state.
The question is this right here, the basic exception guarantee? And the answer is yes, it's going to turn out that this line is this line applied to this and all the parameters is in fact the basic exception guarantee.
I'm sorry, it isn't. It's in spirit, it is very close, but it isn't.
Go ahead.
Because being initialized is not an invariant of int, unfortunately.
Right.
If it was, then this would be the
okay, the point being made is that being initialized is not an invariant of int.
You have to look at unfortunately.
Yes. I'm not going to go that far. I'm not going to go as far as to say unfortunately there. What I'm going to say is that this is an approximation to what people call the basic exception guarantee, because the basic exception guarantee is written in terms of class invariance, and proper is a little bit better than class invariance. But proper and class invariance are very close. I'm going to point out, and in fact, here is something we know about proper. We don't want proper for a const integer to mean writable. So proper for a const integer is, go ahead.
So just back on the exception thing. I don't know that you really want to say readable. So the caller of foo, when he gets something back, there was an exception that got thrown. And you claim the X is readable, but because it's in a valid but unspecified state, reading from it puts you into undefined behavior.
So the question is, do I really want to say that this is readable on an exception? Even in the other case, because there are situations where the variable could be in an unspecified state. Unspecified state the suggestion is that reading from a variable in an unspecified state is undefined behavior. That's not true. Reading from an uninitialized variable is undefined behavior. Reading from a variable that you don't know what state it is in is perfectly okay as long as it's initialized. I'll get to you. And the further question is, does that mean I don't want to say proper here? And I'm going to say that this is only the basic interface. If you can't meet the basic interface, you probably want to write some special interface. Yes?
I wanted to say that reading from a variable that's in a valid but unspecified state is the only way to determine what state it is in.
Yes.
And you can turn, by doing that, you can turn the behavior back into defined if you can recognize all of the different states and then figure out what to do based on that.
Okay, the suggestion is that reading from a variable that's in an un... I'm not going to get to the end of this. The suggestion is that reading from a variable that's in an unspecified state, but valid, by which I think you mean initialized, and various other things, but yes. It comes down to reading from a readable variable is okay. And if you can't make sure that's true, then you need to have a different interface. The basic interface is not the interface to every function. In fact, probably an awful lot of functions should have a more specific interface than the basic interface. But let's get back to proper. Interesting thing about proper, two different propers, even though proper is kind of like a class invariant, two different propers for different CV qualifiers. Here's what proper really is. Proper is a sequence of assertions specific to the CV qualified type that are implicitly claimed as applied to parameters, function results, and thrown exceptions, plus some Weasley words about when to apply it to star this, immediately before responsibility is passed between neighborhoods. So proper isn't quite nailed down for all types here. I've told you proper for what I think proper for int is in both the const and the non-const, and I didn't even talk about the volatile cases. But proper is the place where you can extend this to do interesting things in the basic interface without having to write complicated interfaces all the time. A proper object is one that satisfies the usual expectations when you pass it to a function or return from a function, or throw an exception from a function. But proper just means the usual things for this type. And we can have arguments about what proper is later for some types. I think I've got int pretty well. Okay, let's get back to our program. Here, oh look, I did actually notice that I hadn't initialized here. If I have this caller, we now get proper wrong here. The caller is leaving it uninitialized. X is not proper in this case because usually, when you pass an int reference, it has to be readable. Here we have a function that didn't really need that, but now we've got this implicit claim that we're violating. So can we broaden this to get us to not have that implicit claim? And here's a syntax. I'm not very happy with this syntax, but here is a syntax. When I write improper on the declaration, there are no implicit claims of propriety for that object, for that L value, I should say. This, of course, is also a problem because now I've gone way too weak because all of them went away. In particular, over here, this'll work now. It's not undefined behavior. But in this neighborhood, we don't know it will work. So we have this weird situation of, we want to write to this thing. It's not that weird. We want to write to this thing, but we don't know it's writable locally. Locally, writable acts like permission to write. If we don't know it's writable, we don't have permission to write. So this is actually a problem we want our proof to go through. We can put in an explicit claim. Now at this point, this is locally writable. That much is fine. And we now have a problem over here. We don't know this is readable. And same problem. If nobody tells us it's readable, it's not readable to us. We don't have permission. So we'll put a claim of propriety in there, and that'll get us past that. And we're probably going to want to put a claim of writability here so that you know we haven't gotten rid of the writability somehow, even if an exception was thrown. That demonstrates working with improper is really hard. Don't think you need to do it very much. I think that bit better syntax, maybe there's something other than, there are other things than improper you can put in the brackets there. We can probably make that better, but I'm moving on.
Could I just ask, why would you, if proper is something that could possibly be extended over time, wouldn't you want to just explicitly forgive that it doesn't need to be writable, as opposed to saying everything else improper that is okay? Just say, you know, delete that it needs to be readable.
So the question is, should there be I think the suggestion is that there should be a syntax for starting with proper and editing it down instead of clearing it out of the way and editing it up.
Yes.
And if I knew how to do that, I would be happy. I don't.
I think this is better, frankly.
Okay.
I mean, you have a nice warning right in your interface, right in the declaration. That this thing isn't going to be treated ordinarily.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so the comment is, that's not a universal opinion. Improper seems to be a good warning for some people, and I lean that way, but the number of things you have to build up is a bit of a problem. One suggestion that I took out some slides, I don't know if I can make it work, but could you just say writable in there? And there, if you said writable in there, then instead of claiming proper, it would be claim writable. Yes?
I guess I'm confused as to like the purpose of that improper keyword or whatever there. Like if that wasn't there, yeah. If you have claim writable here instead of claim proper, absolutely, then it's not claiming it's proper, it's just claiming it's writable, not didn't say anything about readable.
Ah. So the question is, if I say claim writable, I'm not claiming proper also. No. The implicit assertions are always present unless you make an effort to get rid of them. So here, I've said improper, they went away. Unless I say improper, and I won't be saying improper for the rest of the talk, they're always there. Yes?
So maybe having, it just seems kind of strange that it would be up there in the, mm-hmm. And next to the argument, as opposed to like an unclaim.
Okay, another vote for some way to unclaim things. Unclaiming is logically hard, but unclaiming wouldn't. There is something going on, which is, well, all through here we haven't made the implicit claim yet because the implicit claims come last. So maybe it could be made to work, but I don't know how. But I want to get back to the thing that happened over here with the writability, where the writability worked like a permission, and the readability over there worked like permission to read. I think that's a great thing. We don't really care about some global platonic sense of writability. We care about local writability. Is it okay in this neighborhood to write to this thing? So I'm going to come up with a new definition of writability. And this one's a little weird. Local version of writability has no effect when writable has previously been asserted in the responsible neighborhood more recently than T appears to have been destroyed. These are weasel words we might come back to later if we have time. Otherwise, behavior undefined. And this one is a little tricky because what it seems to be saying is that things are only writable, you can only claim writability if you've already claimed writability. Or, yes, asserted writability anyway. There is an exception here. If you actually have the constructor right there, you can say, yeah, coming out of the constructor, that counts. And assuming it's a non-const object. Anyway.
Sorry. Writable, as you've already explained it, already has no effect. Unless I'm misunderstanding.
I'm changing the conditions under which it has no effect to be stateable locally.
It unconditionally has no effect.
No. It has no effect if...
Yes, the writable is about making a distinction between a no effect and an undefined behavior. So as a... So the thing about this is it always looks like, unless we constructed the object ourselves, writability comes from another, a claim of writability comes from another claim of writability. And that's just fine. Because that other claim of writability didn't have to be one that our neighborhood was responsible for. If it was in our prologue, then our caller was responsible for that claim of writability. And our caller can trace that back to maybe its prologue, where there's another claim of writability, and go back to its caller, and so forth, and when we stitch it together, the writability traces a path backward through our execution all the way to construction. So the writability globally, we don't see this when we're doing the local proof, but globally, writability tracks from construction and ideally ends up at destruction. Likewise, readability has a local version. Very much the same thing, except for the parenthetical here is that something can become readable not only by constructing it, but things can become readable by assigning to them, because assignment turns an uninitialized, unreadable thing into a readable thing. So, I see some screams here, but I'll get to you in a second. So readability actually tracks back much the same way. Previous claim of readability, back to possibly our prologue, back to over many functions, back to either an initialization or an assignment. If it's an initialization, fine. We really knew it was readable at that point. If it tracks back to an assignment, then there's an interesting split, because the assignment has two parameters. We could track the writability back to the construction of the object, or we could track the readability of the assigned from variable back to wherever it came from, and that lets us track both the path of the value and the path of the object. Yes?
Sorry, I'm finding this very confusing. So, what this appears to do is to weaken the readable assertion and writable assertions under some circumstances. Mm. It appears to say that if I looked up here and I saw that it was writable, no matter what happened in here, even if I somehow called a function that destroyed it through a reference, it's still writable, or I'm gonna not do the check.
Mm-hmm.
I don't care.
So the comment is, this seems to weaken things because we don't know if something has been destroyed. And I do have my weasel line here. Appears to have been destroyed. Appears to have been destroyed. I doubt we're going to get that far, you know, during the talk, but appears to have been destroyed will turn out to have been to actually track the right condition for that. Yes.
I think that what we really should be looking at there is when writability was not asserted by the epilogue of an operation that came before. Because if that takes writability away, no matter what the implementation did.
Okay, the answer is we should be tracking back to the most recent epilogue, we should track back to the most recent epilogue the writability came out of, rather than back necessarily to our caller, and that is true. I wasn't going to go there yet, but it gets, yeah, it'll be true. Okay, I guess we will get to a little bit. We can have a little bit of how do we track that? Well, you have a way of tracking things. We're going to invent an assertion, or a thing to assert, rather. Here's destructible. Works very much the same way. It tracks back just like the others. But the interesting thing is we're going to use destructible as permission to destroy. And of course, an actual object is always, in some global sense, destructible. Otherwise, it wouldn't be an object. But an L value doesn't necessarily refer to a destructible object. It might not refer to anything at all. So destructible is how we are going to keep track of whether or not something has been destroyed. And if we don't give a function permission to destroy, then it had better not destroy it. Let's see. So do you remember this? The mysterious gap where the implementation was? This is where we find out what might happen that concerns us as the caller in the mysterious gap. And I'm going to say, in that gap, anything that is locally readable by the other neighborhood might be read from. Anything that is locally writable by the other neighborhood might be written to. Anything that is locally destructible by the other neighborhood, and we can see all of those things because we can watch the prologue execute, but only those things are going to be destroyed among the things we know about. That is, some, you know, the implementation might create and destroy plenty of its own objects, but it won't mess with ours. And it won't mess with any globals we know about, unless it mentioned them in the prologue. Am I assuming an integer reference is destructible by default? That is destructible part of proper for an integer reference? And there's actually a slide coming up, but the answer is no. So I will go further. Among the things the caller knows about, only things locally readable to the implementation at this point will be read from. Only things locally writable will be written to. Only things locally destructible will be destroyed. And that gives the caller some idea of what's not going to happen to the caller's objects. And that's really useful. And here we go. Come to the slide. The question is there an implicit claim of destructible in the basic interface at these three points? And the answer is, no, we don't want to give every function permission to destroy our objects. But should I go slower for this? I think we pretty much agree. We pass a parameter. We don't expect it to get destroyed. That's not the basic interface. It's maybe an interface that happens sometimes.
No, but wait. There's a difference between whether it's going to be destroyed and whether it is destructible. Whether it could be destroyed.
Remember, this is local destructibility. It acts like permission. If I don't give permission, it shouldn't happen.
Fair enough.
I didn't actually repeat the question. I think that statement encapsulated the answer pretty well anyway. So there are, however, a couple of implicit claims of destructibility in the basic interface. They're just in the subtle spots. If we return a result, we have an implicit claim of destructibility of that result, because now it's the caller's problem to destroy it. Likewise, if we throw an exception, that exception had better be destructible, because somebody's going to need to destroy it later. It may seem like you can't violate these. That's not true. If you try, you can violate these. There are a couple more when we move on to constructors and destructors. There's an implicit claim of destructibility on entry to the destructor, which seems sense. That's the place where you need the destructibility. There's an implicit claim of destructibility for the exception. That's the boring one. There's also this posit. Posit is the other assertion. Posit is the universal quantifier over execution paths. And what this is getting at, and it's not actually perfect there. There's something a little more subtle going on. But what this is getting at is that this is the point where it becomes destructible. Anyone after this point can assume this object is destructible. Yes?
So, does your basic interface allow destructors to throw? Because
the question is, does my basic interface allow destructors to throw? And destructors are allowed to throw. Any function is allowed to call terminate, because terminate cannot violate its post conditions. Yes?
Just to see if I understand posit. Let's say that you have an assignment operator and you're assigning a readable variable to another variable. Is that where you would say posit readable to the value you have assigned to?
The question is, an example of posit, if you assigned to a variable, is that where where readability is posited? You're on the right track. That would be implicit in the interface to assignment, except that, yeah, actually, it's pretty much true. The very fine grain below the level of, you know, what actually happens in an assignment is more tricky than, you know, there is an interface for an assignment. It's hard to write. and I'm not quite there yet. But yes. The point being that after an assignment, that's when you learn that the object is readable. Okay, there are a couple of other things that get implicitly asserted specifically in constructors and destructors, so I will mention them now. I'm going to say that there is a concept called unoccupied space, not concept in the technical sense. And we can say on entry to a constructor, star this points to unoccupied space. And that's a kind of complicated notion of its own. It has parts. But I'm going to use this as, yes, that's unoccupied space. It's OK to construct something there. Likewise, construction fails. We have unoccupied space. Exit from a destructor, either way, we have unoccupied space. I don't think that's terribly controversial. It is a limitation, but I'm not terribly bothered by it.
So you're saying that if a destructor throws, and you're supposed to fix the problem and call the destructor again. That is not the part of the basic interface.
The point being made is that if the destructor throw, the suggestion is you're supposed to call the destructor and do it again. No. The answer is even if the destructor throws, that space is now unoccupied. Yes. Okay.
That was your last chance.
What do we have here? Oh, example of using destructible explicitly now, because we're not going to use destructible parameters implicitly in an interface. And here, this is, of course, the stupid way to do an assignment. We're going to destroy the existing thing and placement new a new value onto it. Don't do this for a number of reasons. But I'm going to do it this time to show one possible thing that could happen. Suppose we have this. Here we have an implicit claim of destructibility that happens because we implicitly call the destructor. And we have no destructibility coming out of here. We have assumed it's already gone because this function says I'm taking something in that's destructible and doesn't give us destructibility back. And so that claim, implicit claim of destructibility, is going to blow up on us. That's not so bad because our proof won't go through. And that would be fine. What would be worse is if A was on the heap. Now we have no implicit claim of destructibility, but we've just leaked A, and we would kind of like to catch that, because if the destructibility doesn't, if the destructibility is lost, we can't ever destroy A. So what we would like our destructibility to do is track A from construction to destruction, and we don't ever want to lose track of it, because if we lose track of it, that means we're not going to destroy that. No one will ever have permission to destroy that variable. So I'm going to put in another implicit assertion. This one is one that can't easily be stated in the language, but I think we want it every time. At the end of, when we exit from a function, there is no leaked destructibility. Yes.
I think what you meant to say when you said we have leaked A is you meant to say we've leaked star A.
Yes, I said that we had leaked A.
Given that
and
there was a pointer that slid.
Yes, A was a pointer in that slide. Somehow it's not anymore. But A was a pointer on that slide, and we had leaked star A, the thing that A pointed to. Thank you. So here we will say this function, because it has destructible objects that are still around as we exit, but it doesn't tell the caller that those objects are destructible, that's a leak. And that's still local reasoning, because we didn't actually have to look at the caller to see that that was a problem. And again, this is sort of move the fire into the same neighborhood where you have the problem. What's the next slide about? Right. If you want to get rid of that problem, you write claim destructible X here, and now there is no leaked destructibility, because the destructibility is seen by the caller. The caller, the permission to destroy comes back to the caller. Yes?
So what you're saying is that if you explicitly claim permission to destroy, you have to claim permission to destroy back on the outro.
The suggestion is if you claim permission to destroy on the way in, you have to explicitly claim permission to destroy on the way out. And that's only true if the object is destructible when you leave. If we hadn't done this new, we would claim destructibility on the way out.
Yeah. So how would we claim destructibility on the line storage of int?
How would we, I don't even, the question is, how would we claim the destructibility on the stud aligned storage of int?
Because
I'm not quite sure what that means, and I probably want to move on.
Int is destroyed.
The question is the memory still there and the int destroyed? And yes, it turns out that destructibility is actually a little bit more complicated, and readability and writability tie into this, that you need to, for pod types, destructibility and storage lifetime really need, well, okay, storage lifetime is the more important thing for pod types and destructibility for non-pod types, but I didn't want to get into the distinction between storage lifetime and destruction in this talk. But yes, if you actually try to write out what is destructibility in terms of smaller primitives, what is readability and writability in terms of smaller primitives, you're going to end up looking at storage lifetime separately. Okay, I am going to say, even on an exception, no leak destructibility. I don't think that's controversial. You don't want to leak your memory even if there's a even if destructibility goes wrong. And now we can ask another question. How about readability and writability? Is it okay to leak readability and writability? After all, not much actually gets rid of readability and writability now that we know about destruction. And so we could maybe make this work. But of course, I put my answer at the end. Okay, this one is not as good as the answer I'm going to give, because I've thought of a better one. We want writability to track all the way from destruction of the object to the point where the object is destroyed, so that we know the writability is thrown away when the object is destroyed. If we leak the writability, if we allow leaking the writability, we can't do that. Likewise, the readability comes, part of the readability comes from the writability side, tracks along with the object, and we want it to end up at the destructor and get thrown away with the rest of it. So permission to read, permission to write, we want them to make their way back home for destruction. It does suggest that destructible const is actually a different assertion. Claiming destructible of a const reference is actually a slightly different assertion than destructible for a non-const reference. Because for the non-const reference, you have to get the writability back before you can destroy it. Question.
Okay, when I think about these things making it back home, what you say about we want this to happen, first of all, I don't know why you're saying we want this to happen, but the intuition for me is that the programming model for that everyone assumes when you pass something by reference is that it's not going to end its lifetime, and it's not going to change its properties, right? That you might replace the value, but the basic properties of readability and writability are going to be maintained. Mm-hmm. And I think that's a strong argument for saying we want no leaked readability or writability to be the default. But it sounds like you're saying something else. Are you?
I think I am in part saying that.
Okay.
I'm not. I don't think I can repeat that.
Okay.
But I think it. The question is, am I saying something about we don't want readability or no leaked readability or writability, end quote, to be the default? And my answer here is going to be pro. I want these assertions to be the default. And I'm going to combine that together and say that there are no leaked capabilities. And in another talk one day, we may talk about other capabilities and user-defined capabilities and what a capability is. But for now, no leaked readability, no leaked capabilities means no leaked readability, writability, or destructibility. Okay, so where are we going with this slide? I've lost my place. This is a tricky bend. Here we're back to the same thing, and we've got our claims of propriety implicitly, and we've got our claims of destructibility. So you might think this is going to be just fine, but there's a way to give that function undefined behavior. We'll call it like this. Yes.
So I think this will be enlightening. Can you tell me what claims you would make for STD swap? Would they be the default claims, or would there be more? Would they be more detailed than that?
Okay. The hope for a enlightening statement is, what claims would I make for STD swap? And the answer is, they are not the default claims. I think do the default claims apply? I don't even know. But definitely you want something stronger than the default claims, because you want to say that the things actually got swapped.
Okay, what about capabilities?
And what about the capabilities? Yes. I'm going to punt. I don't think I will answer that well enough to be enlightening in this much time. So here we have a way to make this go wrong. If we call this function with the same variable twice, because I went and passed it in by reference, here we destroy A. Here we read from A, which has been destroyed. It's at the very least, I think, in an uninitialized state. Just what this means is a little funny in the standard, but it's not a good idea. I will call this a fire. So the problem is, this function wasn't written to support aliasing of its two parameters. And this is a general problem. Whenever you have multiple L values referring to the same thing, and one of them is writable or destructible, if you don't know that they refer to the same thing, you're in a dangerous situation. It's not safe to write or destroy. So I'm going to make a definition here. Two L values are irresponsibly aliased when in an interface — this can only happen in an interface — when the aliasing is not communicated across the interface. That is, when I'm making a function call, if I know things are aliased, but the function I'm calling can see them but doesn't know they're aliased, that would be irresponsible aliasing. Returning from a function, if the implementation knows that something is aliased, that two L values are aliased, but it doesn't communicate to the caller that those things are aliased, and the caller can actually, the caller can have a problem with aliasing there. So this is a bit weaselly, but it's actually not that hard. We do it by checking the particular execution paths. Same way we check everything else. We walk down execution paths. If there's loops, we'll do inductions and so forth. That's last year's talk. But the point is, the execution path through the responsible neighborhood knows, and the execution path in the part of that execution path that's shared doesn't say that they're aliased. That's where the problem happens. And I'm going to annoyingly mess with readable and writable and destructible again and say there's a local non-aliasing version of writable. This one includes the old stuff plus not irresponsibly aliased to anybody, to any L value that may be readable, writable, or destructible in an irresponsible neighborhood. So this clause only applies in interfaces, because outside of an interface, there is no irresponsible neighborhood. Much the same thing with readable. You can get away with aliasing to readable things under some circumstances, and that's going to be, I may not be handling that right. That's something where I think more work is needed. The aliasing to readable things is okay sometimes part. Destructible, very much like writable, you can't alias something to a destructible object without telling people. Yes, I'm trying to move kind of fast through this. So here, the problem with, now that I've made those changes, calling foo with the same parameter twice is going to blow up here in the claim of propriety, because y is readable. We claim that y is readable, and x is already claimed writable at this point. And so we have had irresponsible aliasing at this point. Now, of course, sometimes you want to write code where aliasing is okay. Is that where I'm going with this? Okay, I think he's saying his question involved, well, we wanted to, sometimes we want to write code where aliasing is okay. But that's not what the next slide is for some reason. What's on the next slide? We will get there. Oh, it is what's on the next slide. Little change to this function. We made aliasing okay in this function, but not in the interface yet. So we still have the problem, and now we want to modify the interface so that aliasing isn't a violation. Here is one way to modify the interface so that aliasing is not a violation. I'm going to claim right here that those things are definitely aliased. Now it's clear. The caller is responsible for making sure that those two refer to the same object. We are just fine with them referring to the same object, so we're good. Different approach.
Thank you.
Because sometimes we might want to have callers that have different objects, and now they blow up on that claim. So we're going to change the we're going to make it a little looser. Here, when these are different objects, we have an execution path that comes through here, definitely not aliased. That's just fine. If we switch back to the caller where that's the same object, we're going on this execution path. Definitely aliased, not irresponsible though. That's just fine too. So that's how you can say maybe aliased. Use an OR, because OR is kind of maybe operation.
So the definition of writable, readable, and destructible basically says if you have a claim that pertains to this, I mean, my problem with this is that I can't see how to teach a computer to say, well, this claim actually says exactly irresponsible aliasing is, so this magically has an effect on those.
Mm-hmm. So the question is, he can't figure out how to teach a computer to say that, to actually do the proof or do the check, depending. I changed the definition of readable and writable and destructible to be the non-aliasing versions, and that's kind of hard. It's writing, so I will say that if you had debugging code, just debugging, you know, it is possible to instrument a single neighborhood to check this. It's not fast to instrument it like that. And you do have to actually have, you know, things that you're, you know, when you make a function call, you would have to actually know that, you know, you would have to have the prolog of the function you're calling be instrumented. So not super easy. I think we could get there. And the other question is proof, and I believe it is provable. And it more or less comes down to, in the base cases, there are only so many objects you're checking this for. And in the inductive cases, you're only adding so many more objects, and you do the proof. And it's not like it's a hidden proof. It's, you know, things are alias, you know, you do, you know, you're, when you're looking at proofs, you have to look at, you know, places where pointers are where pointers are necessarily equal. And that's not trivial. That's last year's talk. But I believe we can make it work. Okay. Now, this isn't exactly the usual signature for assignment. The usual signature of assignment is we would return a reference to X. The usual signature for assignment has irresponsible aliasing in it, because we return a reference, you know, we return writability to X, and we return a writable reference that is the result, and that's irresponsible aliasing. So in this case, we are going to have to write, these are definitely aliased. And this is a situation where you don't want an or. It's not, maybe it's aliased. We want to say, these are definitely aliased. And I think a case can be made for, beyond the basic interface, there is a default interface for particular sorts of functions, like assignment operators. If you write something that is named as an assignment operator, maybe you get a special, yes, that's going to refer there. But I'm not going to talk about the default interface for particular names today much. Okay, the further question, of course, that we have something that we might want to write into some interfaces is, are these part, you know, is possible aliasing between the parameters and the results part of the basic interface? That is, does the basic interface say maybe things are aliased, maybe they're not, for whole parameters and whole results? Definitely we want it to not have, like, is this Boolean alias to the red black flag in the tree that we're passing in or something? No, don't do that. That's why no aliasing needs to be the default, because you don't even know all the stuff you're passing in. So the question is, for these simple cases, do we want it to be, maybe there's aliasing as part of the basic interface? It would make assignment stream operators and swap fit the basic interface, but that's not so useful because now we have everything is more complicated, and those things needed their own interface anyway. So my answer is no, but I think this is, people could argue. Okay, how much overtime are we, and how much overtime can we be?
Well, your 20 minutes are time, but there's no limit.
So we really probably should. Well, I want to vote for this talk, so.
Okay. So the last bit is a deep dive. I will find a way somehow to deliver the rest of this talk, but I will let people have a break. And if you can manage it, could you hang on to the card and we could, like, have a bathroom break and vote if we need to, and I can finish the talk. People feel good about that? Okay. In that case, and can you keep the card going, or should I do a, okay.